And we're gonna, I know that things are kind of rough. I know the weather's kind of bad. I know there's people all over the place. And so I was asking God to show me a better way to do New Year's. We tried it at 7 o'clock, which is good. But today I just honestly felt led by the Lord to go ahead and talk to the Lord at 12 today. You got your Bible, turn to Proverbs chapter 3. Just hold on for a minute, because I'm not going to go there yet. There's something I couldn't wait to do. One thing I got to do is get the praise and worship on, but sermon up, that would help.
Here we are.
We're here we are again. It's at the first of the year. Now, I did some studying on New Year's resolutions, and of course, some of the top resolutions is I'm going to quit smoking, I'm going to start eating right, I'm going to start exercising. The number one resolution. How many know what the number one, how many can guess what the number one New Year's resolution is across the board? Number one resolution. Lose weight. That's the number one. These weight companies are having them a ball right now. You want to lose weight for Christmas? Now you want to lose weight for New Year's? You want to get rid of the holiday fat that you put on? Well, the best way to keep getting holiday fat is don't put it on at holiday. Eat like you got some sense of the holiday, too. I can still sample all the food. My daddy said, son, aren't you going to eat? I said, I just ate. He said, but you didn't eat. I said, daddy, I just ate collards, pigtails, like dumplings and collards. I ate the dumplings and the potatoes. And I ate stuff. And I ate all of that. He said, I didn't see you eat. I said, that's because you never picked your head up to see. I said, I ate one plate and I put it down. And I did not gain any weight over the Christmas holidays. Again, it's all got to do with discipline anyway. So here we are. So now watch this now. This is so awesome. If this thing here will work again. Here we go again. Praise God. There we go. Come on up here, buddy. Do it right. You can do it. You can do it. There you go. New Year's resolutions. I did a study, again, across the board. New Year's resolutions basically fall into three major categories. Did you know that? There's all kinds of resolutions. I'm going to spend more time with God, spend more time with my kids, blah, 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 blah. But if you put it all together and you put them in a pot and you take them out and you put them in categories, basically three categories. And here it is. They deal with, number one, things that make you look better and live longer. Things that make us have more. Things that help us get along with everyone. That's it. If you want to think about it, all the resolutions, you can put them all together and say, how can you talk about all the resolutions? There they are. Things that make us look better and live longer. Exercise. Things that make us have more. I'm going to have more of God this year. I'm going to have more at work this year. I'm going to take more time. So again, it's things that make us have more. Things that help us get along. I'm going to learn how to keep my mouth shut. That's what I've never learned.
Amen.
I'm going to learn how to speak up when I should. Blah, blah, blah. I'm going to learn better relationship skills. You know, and I tell you what, if you come here on Sunday, usually, just about every Sunday, there's some kind of relationship skill being taught every Sunday, and even on Tuesday nights, there are relationship skills always mixed in with the sermon. So again, watch this. If you want to look at all this, and you want to put these biblically in perspective, here it is, longevity, prosperity, and peace. If you want to look at biblically what we just talked about, the three categories, here it is. Biblically speaking, here's the three categories: longevity, prosperity, and peace. Every last one of us could use some longevity. Amen. You know, I was just talking with a friend of mine yesterday, and I think I have buried five of my classmates. Five. I got a call yesterday. I was Linda's car. The battery had died, so I was at O'Reilly's trying to get a car battery. While I'm trying to get a car battery, I get a call from one of my cousins. And he says, hey, cuz, I said, what? He says, I need your help. I said, anything you need, you let me know. He said, mama's dying. I said, okay, what do you need me to do? And he says, I need you to get ready so when she dies, you can do her funeral. I said, well, what about now? And he said, well, she's in hospice care. She's out of palliative care in Greenwood. So she may not last a week out. And I'm not sure she even knows if you went to see her, but you can go if you want. Well, I went home last night, told my wife, and she said, oh, that's sad. We prayed for her. And then I hadn't sat down 10 minutes and I get another text, mama died. So again, longevity. No matter how long you live, everybody would love to have one more day. Amen? I want to be with God. I'm going to tell you, I can't wait to get to heaven. The older I get, the more I can't wait to get to heaven. But at the same time, I know if my time was coming, I'd want one more day. Right. Amen? Because there's always something you want to get done, something you want to change, whatever. But, and then, prosperity. Look. It ain't fun not being able to take care of yourself. It's not fun. And all of us, at time to time, had to have somebody help us. And we need to be willing to help somebody else at any time. But also, not just prosperity or the ability to take care of myself, but in just peace. Elvis. I was listening to a thing on the radio the other day, and it said, they start talking about the top songs or the top singers that had, they talked about how many, back then, how many remember 45s?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, 45s used to, y'all that don't know what the dinosaurs, let me tell you about the dinosaurs used to. Y'all got CDs and MP3 players and all this, and you stream it live and stream it live. We bought 45s. There was an A side and a B side. Usually the A side was something popular, the B side was just something they threw up there. And so it's even like Gene Autry. When Gene Autry did this one song, there was one song Gene Autry was in the summer. Gene Autry was trying to finish up his Christmas album. He was doing it in the summertime, and there was a B side. There was one room for one more B side song. It was the album though. It was the whole album, not just the A B. But it was a B side song, meaning it was not even considered even to be worthy to put out there, other than just to fill some space. He has room for one more song. His wife calls him and says, "Honey, I need you to record this song." He said, "Dear, I don't like that song. We're not going to record it." She said, "You promised me that you would record this song." He said, "Okay, we've got time in the studio for one take. One take. One. No backups, no do-overs, one take." He said, "We can do it in one take. I'll put it on the album." She says, "Okay." So he did it in one take. It was a B-side song. It became the second most requested Christmas song of all times. Next to White Christmas, which is number one, guess what number two? Now I'm talking about secular song. Number two, guess what the second song, entire song of all times for Christmas is?
Rudolph.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Yeah. Okay. So I was looking at the A side and the B sides, and of course, Chubby Checker was the record holder for the Beatles coming on. The Beatles, they had like 15. Both sides were top tens. Both sides, A and B, were top tens. Guess who had the most top tens on both sides, A and B? They had 23 to 25 top tens off of both sides of the record, which is unheard of. Elvis. Guess who one of the most miserable men in the world was? Elvis. When they asked Elvis if he could do something besides sing, you know what they asked him? He was Assembly of God. They asked him if he could do anything besides sing, what would he want to do? You know what he said? Preach. He was miserable. When I was a disc jockey at the radio station on his birthday, for the two-hour show that I had, it was gospel music, I played all Elvis gospel music. You know, for 2 hours straight, I played Elvis gospel and never played the same song twice. He was miserable because although he had all that fortune, all that fame, all that money, anything he wanted, what he wanted most was peace with God that he didn't have. So now, longevity, prosperity, and peace. But in order for us, our resolutions, in order for what we want to do in this year to come up, in order for it to affect our lives, we have to move from resolutions, which is nothing more than mere thoughts. And many times a resolution is nothing more than wishful thinking. A resolution, you know what I heard about resolutions? They go in 1 year and go out the next. So resolutions are thoughts. But now revolution is an attitude. It's kind of like this. I tell people this all the time. Your emotions, if you go ahead and look in water, and God says he calls, the psalmist says the deep is calling to the deep. Jesus said when his men couldn't catch any fish, in the fifth chapter of Luke, he goes, "Cast it on the other side." He said, "And let down your nets deep. Cast out into the deep for a draught." They wanted to cast out shallow. He said, "Cast out deep if you're going to catch any fish." Okay, watch this. Your thoughts, many times, just thoughts. Watch this. If you look at water, the thoughts are on the top of the water, and they are just like this. They bob up and down. They move back and forth. When the wind blows, they go one way. When the wind shifts, it goes the other way. You get a wake from a boat, it goes one way. When you, whatever, because it's on the top, the surface. That's your thoughts. But when you look at commitment, commitment's deep. You know, once you get a certain weight, certain depth of water, it doesn't matter about the waves. It doesn't matter about the wakes. It doesn't matter about the weather. It doesn't matter about anything. Because once you get deep enough in that water, none of the surface stuff matters anymore. It cannot affect you. So thoughts are usually surface, and they're like the waves can toss them to and fro. But now, an attitude or commitment is deep, and it's in the still water. It'll stand strong when nothing else, everything else is being shaken all to pieces. Your attitude and your commitment can stand strong. And so, in order to have something for this new year coming up, we don't want resolutions because they're thoughts. We want attitudes and commitment. That's revolution. That's something, a revolution is whatever it takes. We see resolution is, oh, here's a good plan. But revolution is whatever it takes, we're going to get it done. Now, how many have had resolutions that had the same resolution year after year and still never saw it through usually the first week or two? You know, when we go to the gym, you ought to watch the gym out there behind the hospital. I got in that gym. About November, you got there and you threw a dead cat through the place and not hit anybody. But you know what? Starting this week, when you go out there, you have to fight to find a machine. Because everybody's got, I'm going to lose weight, I'm going to exercise, I'm going to get healthy again. And about 3 weeks down the road, maybe four, it'll start dwindling it off. And by Easter time, you can throw a dead cat across this thing and not hit anybody again. Because it's a short-lived thing. Your thoughts are short-lived. But commitment is strong, and it stays strong in your attitude. So now, y'all can say right now, we're going to read this. I'm going to read it to you, but I'll put it out there so you can see it too. Proverbs chapter 3. We're only going to do the first five. There's 10. Proverbs chapter 3 is a very awesome book. If we could take Proverbs chapter 3 and read it on a daily basis, or at least read it on a weekly basis, and try to do what Proverbs chapter 3 says, it's amazing what can happen in our lives. It's amazing the transformation that can happen in Proverbs chapter 3. So watch this. My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments for length of days and long life and peace. Wow. That's what it's asking for. We just had that. Longevity, prosperity, and peace. Wow. Do you know God wants you to have longevity, prosperity, and peace? So watch. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them around thy neck. Write them upon the table of thine heart. So thou shalt find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. I don't want just favor in the sight of God. I want favor in the sight of man. And I don't want just favor in the sight of man. I want favor in the sight of God. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord, and depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel, and marrow to thy bones. Honor the Lord with thy substance, and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. I said, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. Now this is just the first five. Next week we're going to do the next five. But this is just the first five. So I'm kind of, I promise not to go too long, but I got 45 minutes. That's what we can, if I get through, we can go up here and we can tell some resolutions. All right, ready? Revolution. Watch this. Revolution number one. Get ready. Here we go. Start a New Year's resolution. Revolution. Ready? Get ready. Attitude or revolution or attitude. Just say attitude is revolution. Say it. Attitude is revolution. You know, a lot of times I can tell if I'm going to have a good conversation with you before you ever get to me. You know why? Because, and me too, do you know that usually where you go, your attitude precedes you. And a skillful person, a person that's got any amount of discernment whatsoever can discern your attitude long before you get to them. And if they can't, and even if they have a hard time discerning your attitude by the time you get to them, all you have to do is open your mouth. And your attitude will go before you, and it'll show people how to handle you that day. Okay? There are certain people on that fountain. I can tell when I saw them, okay, this is not going to be a good day. I better not talk to them about this today, because this day I'll get the wrong answer. And you know what? I hate to think that when people got around me, they had to walk on eggshells. because they never knew how my attitude was going to be. Think about that for yourself. Do you want people to have to walk on eggshells around you? If you don't, then ask God to help you stay on an even keel, down deep, where the waves don't affect you. If you stay up top, you'll never know what you got, depending on what's happening. So first, let love and faithfulness never leave you. He said, let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on a tablet in your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God. Amen. Wow. So here it is. Here it is. Love and faithfulness. He's saying, very first thing he's talking about is I want these two qualities to be your guiding light in life. This is going to be your foundation for the rest of them. If you can't get love and faithfulness in the front, then there's no place for love and faithfulness in the back. It's got to be in the front in order for you to carry out the rest of this. If you ain't got this going, then the rest of it's going to be a drudgery. If you ain't got this going, then the rest of it's going to be hard to handle. If you don't have this going, it's going to really have a rough time. So love and faithfulness. Now, so what's the definition of love here? All right, here it is. It's more than feelings. It's more than chemistry. Here it is. Simply, think about this as love. A man with nails in his hands. That's the kind of love it's talking about. It's talking about an active love, a love that reaches out to others, a love that does for others, a love that does for others without thinking twice about it. That kind of love. Now, let me ask you a question. When you come up with somebody and you see them in need, or you come up with somebody, I'm not talking about this crazy mess going on around here now. Every stoplight's got a certain person sitting at each stoplight, and they got them all taken out in Greenville for you to stop, and all of them have the same story. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about real for real. Somebody calls you up and says, I really need a helping hand right now. Somebody calls you up and says, I'm in a bind. Can you help me out with my children? I'm in a bind. Can you help me out? I've got to go somewhere, and I can't feed the person I'm supposed to go feed because now I've got to go somewhere else. Can you go feed them for me? That kind of stuff. True stuff where you're going to have to actually get up, and it's going to cost you physically, mentally, emotionally to help take care of that person's need. I want you to don't raise your hands. I just want you to think about it. In the last year, when these things come upon you, when these things come to you, did you look at them as an opportunity to serve? Did you look at it as a chance to show God's love? Or did you look at it as a bother? Because if you looked at all of it like a bother, that you could not be bothered, let me tell you something, you've missed the button. There's a whole lot of stuff going on. There's a whole lot of stuff happening all around us. You know, like this one night, when Linda was staying at her mama's house, I left her at 9 o'clock and I said, maybe now I can go to Walmart and get through there quick. Bethany and I have got homework to do. We're going to go on home. We're going to run through Walmart real quick. And the first thing I did when I walked down the first aisle, there was somebody. I said, Pastor! I said, hey, how you doing? And I tried to walk away. And they came right behind me, so I stopped. And they said, look, I'm having a problem. Can I talk to you? Sure. Well, about 20 minutes later, I said, okay, I really need to go home. I've got homework to do, and I got stuff I got to get done. I said, okay. So I went down another aisle. And then I hear, Brother Dan! And I thought to myself, I said, Lord, now you know I've got this homework to do. And you know I was going in here. Don't you think you put the cloak shields down number one? And they said, can we talk? Sure. 15 minutes later. I got down another aisle, and now it's one employee from Walmart. And he said, man, I'm having a problem. Me and my wife, we got to talk. We got blah, 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 blah in the church, blah, blah, blah. And I said, okay, let's start talking. And before I knew it, there was about six or seven Walmart employees standing around me. These were the late shift guys. And they were all asking questions. And they were all asking, how do we handle this, blah, 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 blah. It was 11:30 before I got out of there. I said, Lord, you know I got homework to do. And he spoke to my heart and said, you just did it. So I went home. I laid in and looked, and I said, tomorrow, closed it up, went to sleep, because I just did my homework. My homework was to use the stuff I'm learning and also to help them with their home. So again, at the beginning, I'll be honest with you, I said, Lord, I didn't say it out loud as a bother, but I said, Lord, I got homework to do. You think we just get in and get out? And sometimes I think when you tell God what you need, what you want, I think he giggles. Yeah, right, sure. Anytime, brother. Yeah, you do that, okay? I can hear him now. Yeah, David, you go ahead. We got this. But as I started moving through the house and the things started hitting, then I realized I weren't in here to get cereal for the next day. And I weren't in here to get milk. And I weren't in here to get some Pop-Tarts. I was in here to minister to these guys. So let me ask you a question. What motivates you? Are you motivated by true Christian love, agape love, the nails in the hand kind of love? Something's going to cost you. Something that's going to cause pain for you is going to cost you. And you'll be misunderstood, but you still do it. When you get that kind of love in you, something special starts taking place. So the first definition is of love. The second definition, of course, is for faithfulness. Watch this. Faithfulness is literally, watch this, keeping the faith, maintaining allegiance, being constant, loyal, showing a strong sense of duty or responsibility, conscientious, reliable. I love this in the Hebrew. I love it. I love it. A faithful copy. Are we a faithful copy of our Father? Are we a faithful copy of the Word? Are we a faithful copy of what Jesus would do? So, you know, I was over there, somebody was talking about, I heard somebody, they were getting on, I got to have the mind of Christ. I got to have the mind of Christ. I really got to have the mind of Christ. They were going on and on about the mind of Christ. And the Lord just spoke to me and said, Philippians 2 and 5. So I spoke to the person and said, you want the mind of Christ? Here it is, Philippians 2 and 5. Let his mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who was in the form of God, but thought not robbery, that all who was equal with him to take on the form of servant. Become a man. When you die, you want the mind of Christ. That's the mind of Christ. That's what the Bible says. Again, love and faithfulness. Attitude, revelation. Two. Come on up, everybody. You can do it. Revolution number two, or attitude number two. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight, or he will direct your path. And here's the, I'll be quick now. Just a couple I want to stop and camp out at, but I'm going to move quick. Definition of trust. Ready? Firm belief in or confidence in integrity, reliability, justice of another person or thing, faith in reliance on the person or thing. I trust my God. I trust him more every day. I trust him because I see him doing things I never thought were imaginable. I think sometimes we don't get much in our faith walk because we don't expect much. We walk around with the attitude, well, if I haven't had a Christian friend in my family or a Christian a family member tell me, if I don't expect much, then I won't be disappointed. So I just don't expect anything. And I said, that's a sad way to live. You gotta expect something from God. You gotta expect something in this life to live life to its fullest. So trust the Lord with all your heart. Literally means, watch this. All your heart, get ready. If you got a pencil, you're taking this, write this down. With all your heart means literally with all your will, your emotions, and your intellect. Are your will, your emotions, and your intellect. If you want to be like the person that's in the deep and that where the waves don't affect them, in that concrete part of the water, that it stays the same temperature, it stays the same without emotion, you got to trust God with all your will, your emotions, your intellect. And then it says acknowledge him in all your ways. That word acknowledge is a pretty cool word too. That word acknowledge, watch this. To recognize the authority or claims of, to verify receipt of a letter, gift, favor, or payment. Acknowledge him. Acknowledge him. Acknowledge him in all you do. I walk around all the time saying, okay, God, it's me and you. It's got to be most of you. Because if it's me, we in trouble. Amen. 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 So now, number three. God told you it's not going to be long. There you go. I'll fly away. Here. Here's the hard one. This is my hardest one. Be not wise in your own eyes. Wow. Be not wise in your own eyes. Simply as this. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil, and this will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. Let me ask you a question. Do you pray for what your New Year's resolutions are going to be, or do you just say, well, you know what? I think I need to lose some weight this year. That's what I'm going to pray about. I think I need to do this. That's what I'm going to pray about. That's what I'm going to do for resolution. No. Do you talk to God? Do you ask him? Show me, God, what you want me to do. Teach me. Teach me, God. You know, it's like this. Let me just say this. If you and your spouse are still arguing today over what you argued about 5 years ago, something hadn't been done right. I want to talk about the category. I'm talking about the exact thing. If you and your wife, or you and your husband, or you and your child are arguing about the same things today that you argued about 5 years ago, then something has not been done right. If you're still having the same issue today that you've been dealing with for the last 5 years, and you haven't gotten any resolution to that, here I'm here to tell you, you're over here at the top, you're on the waves, you're going back and forth, you need to get down deep so you don't have to fight that again. Because here's how God works. Until you get that one fixed, he's going to let it keep coming to you. Until you figure it out, he's going to let it keep coming to you because he wants us to overcome. And also, did you ask God for guidance about what you need to work on? Or do you just think, well, I know what I need to work on. It's very obvious. I need to work on blah, blah, blah. No. Ask God. God, what do I need to work on? What is it? Husbands, let me give you a little example. Have you ever sacrificed something for your wife and you knew it was a sacrifice, you knew how much it hurt or what the cost was, and then you showed it to them and they went, yeah. And you said, don't you realize how much I sacrificed and everything I did? And you just go, yeah, what I really wanted was. You ever heard that? Wives, have you ever done it to your husbands? I sacrificed it all. I got it all together. I got it right there. And you give it to them and go, yeah, what I really wanted. The Lord showed me that a couple of years ago, and that revolutionized the way I handle my marriage and my children. Because now, instead of me, what I was doing is I didn't even realize it. Was, yes, I was sacrificing, but I was sacrificing according to my will. My ideas, not theirs. And so, it's okay if I sacrificed, and let's say, in the sacrifice, I gave them blah, blah, blah. But that's not what they needed, and that is not what they wanted. They needed it over here, blah, blah, blah. And so you're sacrificing all this work, but you know what? You wasted your time, you wasted your sacrifice, you wasted all that energy because you did not meet their need. You met their perceived need. You got to meet their need. The same way. God, you show me what I need to work on for me. You show me how to be a better me. Because obviously, I'm not getting it right when I try to do it my way. When I was 17, my favorite song, Elvis used to sing, one of the last songs Elvis sang before he died on his records, was I Did It My Way. Y'all remember that song? I used to sing it all the time. I said, I'm doing it my way. After I got saved, I realized I can't do it my way anymore. I got to do it his way. So, again, do not be wise in your own eyes. And it's hard, especially when you get older and you start getting this experience behind you. You know, How many's ever taken online college courses? An online college course, especially if you're in something called Moodle, you'll find out that you interact with your classmates in every assignment. And when you interact with your classmates in every assignment, what they want you to do, especially in psychology, is they want you to put your own experiences, and they even give you things to do. And do this, and you write back how you did it. And I want you to talk to two more of your classmates, and y'all interact. And it's amazing to me that when I'm interacting with a fellow pastor or just somebody my age that's been in this for years, and when I'm interacting with somebody that's younger and inexperienced, especially in crisis intervention, wow. It was like they couldn't get enough. The young ones couldn't get enough. Tell me some more. And then some of the elders were going, yeah, that's pretty cool. Let me tell you about mine. And so you begin to think, you know what, I got this going on now. I got this. And we can miss it a country mile. Because we think we got it. We understand it. You got to stop. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Number four, and only five. Number four. Ready? Y'all somebody say yes. Yes. If you don't, leave it right there. Ready? Yeah. Attitude number four. This is the hardest. My hardest one was not being wise in your own eyes. But here seems to be the hardest one for a lot of people. And I'm going to bring it to you as New Year resolutions. Revolutions, because some of us need a revolution in this area very badly. Let me show it to you. It says, honor the Lord with your wealth. Wow. He said, I want to prosper you, but in order to prosper you, you have to honor me with your wealth. Verse 9 says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops, then your barns will be filled to the overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. What's it talking about? Very simple. You can sugarcoat it, you can put it any way you want to, you can blast it any way you want to put it up there. What it says is, I want you to start. If you're going to honor me with your wealth, I want you to start with tithing. Your first fruits. If you're going to bless what you're doing, then you're going to have to show me how bad. And watch this. I'm not going to stay here a long time. Watch this. When I start with my tithe, watch this. I'm making several declarations. All right? Ready? My first declaration is to God. I trust you. My second declaration is to Satan. I will not live by fear, but I will live by faith. And my third declaration is to me. I refuse to depend on my wisdom and me alone. I'm going to depend on God. So, when you're doing this, it's amazing what happens. And I'm going to give you just a few little things here just to show you about the attitude of honoring God with your wealth. Ready? Here we go. Real quick. I put a whole, oh, Bethany, you're right. It did do it that time. It's that battery. Bethany told me, said this thing did it all by itself. She's right. Come on, baby. Come on, baby, light my fire. There we go. I just leave it up there. All right, ready? Because I'm a tither. And if y'all want these, I can give this to you. I can give a little sheet of paper to you that you can say in your own declaration. Because I'm a tither and a giver. The windows of heaven are open to me. These are promises from God. So this isn't my promises. This is what God promised me. The windows of heaven are open to me, and God rebukes the devourer for my sake. I am blessed financially and receive a blessing that I cannot contain. Malachi 3:10, Luke 6:38. Luke 4:19, I do not worry about lack, knowing God supplies all my needs richly and abundantly. Therefore, I'm able to sow freely and liberally. Third, I choose to sow cheerfully, generously, and bountifully, knowing that I will reap bountifully. I have in abundance every favor and earthly blessing. All my needs are met, and I abound in every good work. 2 Corinthians 9:6-8. Proverbs 11:24-25. Because I obey him, the Lord blesses everything I put my hands to. He grants me abundant prosperity. He makes me the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. The blessings of God are chasing me and overtaking me. Deuteronomy 28:1-14. And then finally, because God loves to see me prosper, I am believing Him for jobs and better jobs, advancements, riches and bonuses, sales and commissions, good ideas, strategies, debts paid off, expenses decreased, blessings and increases, financial freedom and breakthroughs. That's not my words. That's just taking what God said and combining it all together. All this is what God said, and I'm putting it right here. As He said, if you put me first, I will put you first. And I'm going to tell you what, I sure like being put first by Him. Amen? Now, here's the last one. And then I'm going to ask for a few revolutions before we pray in the new year. When this alarm goes off, I want y'all to shout with joy. Hear me? When that alarm goes off, I want you to holler amen through the top of your lungs. Don't turn around and think that somebody has dropped a whole bunch of snakes in here and you're hollering trying to get away from it. All right, get ready. Ready?
Yes.
Do not despise the Lord's discipline. It's another revolution. My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline and do not resent His rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those He loves as a father, the son He delights in. So now, let me... Here's what I want to show you about this thing now. Now again, are you going to make the changes that He's prompting you to make? I have to say this. Sometimes we feel God's discipline because He's trying to get us to step up to the plate, and we're not stepping up to the plate, so He's prompting us. Again, people look at discipline in a kind of a strange way, kind of a morbid way, because let me tell you this for sure. I want you to think about it. Discipline is not a negative thing. If all you think of is discipline is going to the woodshed, then you got it all wrong. How many, I remember when I first went to work at Procter & Gamble, I'd been there for like, I think it was 6 months, maybe a year. And I remember it was hard getting used to shift work, and it was hard getting used to their way of doing things and going around. And there were some things I had to be qualified in before I could do my actual job. I had to learn shipping and or receiving and or prep. Everybody did, no matter who they were. Then I went into my specialty skill, which was electronics and computers and engineering. I still had to learn this stuff first. And I remember the first couple of months I was spending all my time loading trucks, and it was so aggravating. And I was thinking, God, this is not what I signed up for. And the Lord just kept saying, just keep showing a good attitude, keep showing that good attitude. And as I went through all this disciplinary stuff, it was amazing, because one day I come in and they hand me a certificate. And I said, what's this for? And it was from the state of North Carolina. I was some kind of, I don't even know where it's at now. I don't remember the exact words, but it was like, I have finished my North Carolina industrial apprenticeship. I didn't even know I was doing it. They didn't tell me, well, you're going to get a certificate for all this. But I was getting paid, and I was getting paid good. And when I first went over there, the first few months I was in school. I was in school. That's all I did was school. I went to school for 40 hours a week. That was it. For the first 4 or 5 months, I got a certificate and all this stuff, blah, blah, blah. But then all of a sudden I get thrown into this other stuff. And I go, wait a minute. This is not what I trained for. This is not what y'all told me I was going to be doing, blah, blah, blah. And I said, just chill. Everybody's got to learn it. Learn it. But it's amazing. Although it was not pleasant and it was hurtful, it wound up being an amazing thing, because I looked at it as punishment. And then one day I was sitting there and I was watching these people that did it all the time. They did it. All they did was shipping and receiving. All they did was prep. That's it. That's all they did. That's it. And they were the happiest people. And I was sitting there pouting, because I wanted to be doing electric. I wanted a meter in my hand. I wanted to be doing projects. And instead I was doing shipping and receiving. And I walked around for a couple of months, matter of fire. I hated going to work. I hated all this stuff. And then finally hit me one day. Look how happy they are. And nobody's been mean to you. Aren't you paying your bills? Aren't they giving you the money they said they were going to give you? Aren't they doing what they said? Didn't they give you insurance? Blah, blah, blah. They do all this stuff. And I know you're not doing what they hired you for. But they said you had to do this. It was part of your job description. Everybody, no matter what they did, had to learn this. And when I finally got that in my thick skull, I started enjoying my work. Because I saw it as punishment. But it was discipline. Discipline is nothing more than training. is training, discipleship. How many want to be a disciple of Christ? If you want to be a disciple of Christ, guess what part of that root word for disciple is? Discipline. So there's things that you're going to do that you may not like doing. There's things you're going to do that you may wish you could do in a different way. But discipline. So watch this. I was looking up and I was trying to figure out the best way to describe discipline. So watch this. And then we're going to close. Next time you feel like God's got you on the wood pile. Next time you feel like God's got told you to go out and pick the switch. let me show you something. It's not quite like that. Here it goes. Scared you, didn't it? That's a coach. Alright? So watch this. See? Ready? Come on, coach. There he is. Alright. Next time you see this, don't you think about coaching. God's coaching. He's not beating you. He's coaching you. So watch this. Discipline. And get your Bibles out. We'll look this up. We'll read it while we're going along. Get your Bibles turned to Hebrews chapter 12. We'll read this as we go along. Hebrews chapter 12. We're going to talk about discipline. As a matter of fact, you can tell somebody, you learn something better about discipline now. You enjoy discipline. Because you look at it as a positive, not a negative. Are you ready? Discipline. Chapter 12, verse 5b. Ready? My son, you got to say amen.
Amen.
You got, don't have it, say wait. All right. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. Watch this. Discipline is a sign of love. If God didn't love you, he wouldn't bother you. How many has ever gone to your father and said, and mother and said, Mom, can I do this, can I do that? And they would go, no. And I say, well, my friends can do it. My friends' parents said they can do it, but I can't. And they'd say, well, I'm not their parents. And I'll go, yeah, but how come I can't do it? And they say, that's because you're my son, and I expect you to live by a higher standard. I said, but they see Daniel and Beth, and they go, how come we got to do this? How come it's us? And I go, because you're my children. And when people see my children, I want them to know that they live by a higher standard. And you can watch DC and Daniel and Beth, and you watch all three of them. And I guarantee you, they'll look at Daniel. And last week I was working with Daniel at his house. And Daniel said, Daniel, I went to two different places. And as soon as I walked in the door, first off, they looked at me and said, you got to be David Linton's son. They said, they see all the time. And then they said, you know what? But after I see how they act and react, they said, you got to be David Linton's son because you act just like him. It can't be a good thing, can't be a bad thing. If God didn't love you, he would not bother with trying to make sure you did things right. God loves you just the way you are, but he loves us too much to let us stay that way. Wow. That's worth the price of admission right there. Discipline is a sign of love. Remember this, I can't say enough. If God didn't love you, you wouldn't bother. God loves you just the way we are, but he loves you too much to let you stay that way. Wow. I was out there working in the barn with Daniel. We're wearing it up, and here it comes. Here comes Anna Lane. Anna Lane was in her onesie. She's in her onesie, and she comes walking out, and I don't know what she had on for her shoes. It was cold, and she come running. She was soft. She just knew pawpaw was out there. And she got, I see her step out of the barn, man, out of the garage. She goes, "Paw, Paw!" And she starts running. And Daniel said, "You better get back in that house. And you ain't got a coat on. You ain't got shoes on." I said, "But Daniel, weren't it cute?" He says, "No, Dad, it weren't cute." I said, "Okay." And said, "Working along," and I hear Daniel again say, "Why did I tell you?" And looked again, and she had put on Emery's shoes and put on Emery's coat, so she looked like a little dwarf. And she come running again. And Daniel said, "Don't you make me go back in there." And I said, "But weren't she cute?" He said, "No, Dad." He said, "You wouldn't let me do it." And I said, "No, I wouldn't let you do it." He said, "Why are you going to let them do it?" I said, "I didn't let them. You did." He said, "I didn't let them." Okay. All right. Number two. Notice this was a sign of love. This is good stuff here. Isn't it? All right. Number two. Come on, baby. You can do it. Discipline is a sign of faith. Did you know that? Hebrews chapter 12, verse 10. "For they barely for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. And their chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterwards it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby." Look, you discipline somebody not just because you love them, but because you believe in what they can become. I tell Beth that all the time. I still tell my boys that you haven't even begun to see how far you can go. When things are going bad, I tell DC, because DC is a business owner, and DC worked 100-something hours last week. He worked every day except for Christmas Day, and he worked yesterday. And I told him, DC said, "Dad, sometimes this is killing me." And I said, "Well, let me ask you a question." He said, "Yeah." I said, "Didn't you say you wanted room with the big dogs?" He said, "Yeah, Dad, I did." I said, "Well, you got a choice to make, room with the big dogs or stay under the porch." He said, "But Daddy, this is hard." I said, "That's why some dogs stay under the porch." I said, "The same stuff that you're having problems with today, a year from now will not be a problem to you. You'll be going to something else because God's allowing you to get the hard stuff out of your way first." You discipline somebody not just because you love them, but because you believe in what they can become. So I love them, and I know they can become better. Number three. Discipline is a sign of relationship. Let's go back to 7 and 8. "If you endure chastening, God deals with you as a son. But what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if you be without chastisement, where all the partakers, then you are bastards and not sons." Be encouraged. It means he believes in you, he loves you, he believes in you, and he's investing in the future harvest of greatness in your life. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees, make level paths for your feet, so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather be healed. Hebrews chapter 12. Ready?
Yes.
Get ready. Thank you, Beth. That was funny.
Yeah, it was.
We got 10 minutes before the new year kicks in for us. I don't want it to be long. I don't want to draw them out. I don't want to hear about all the time. I want you quickly and deliberately. Quickly and deliberately, because we got 10 minutes. We'll go around the room. I know it's kind of the normal Sunday morning, but that's okay. Remember, we're going to put in the New Year's Eve service. I want you, each person, to give me one or two of revolutions. Remember, resolution is a thought pattern. Revolution is commitment. It's an attitude. There's a difference. I want you to tell me what you are committed to seeing. And look, and if you say God hasn't really showed you yet, you're committed to checking God out and see what it is. But once he shows you, it's going to be fine. Here's a good one. Okay, I'm not sure what it is yet, but I do know I want to be a better person. I want to be a better Christian. I want to be a better father. I'm going to seek God for him to show me all the things I need to do. But I do know he's always telling me in his word to be that better Christian, to be that better servant, to be that better father. So whatever he shows me to do this year, in order to be that, I plan on giving it my best shot to make it happen. That's how quick it can be. All right? Who would decide to start on? Start on this side. Oh, yeah, everybody, this side's pointing over there. And that side. Okay. I think we'll do. We'll start all the way in the back.
Drove off and I said, what just happened?
Good day. Good day. You said, we're sorry, we might be a little slow today because some of our people didn't come in, our managers aren't here yet, so could you please be patient with us? I'd have been patient, but that's what they told me. He got mad at me. And all I asked was, is there a problem? 20 minutes in the drive-thru window? Is there a problem? You know, and so again, that's been going. That's not been one thing, it was just one place, but it's every place. The other day I ordered some spaghetti from one of the places for my in-laws. And Linda was coming through and said, I'll pick it up for you. And so I said, I want spaghetti. I want a family-sized spaghetti. They said, okay. And then I said, but I don't want the deluxe spaghetti. I want the regular spaghetti, family-sized regular spaghetti. I get there, and Linda goes in and says, it's going to be $6. She said, from the spaghetti my husband just ordered? I said, sure. And they gave her this little bitty thing. And she said, is that what my husband ordered? She said, sure. And so she comes to me and hands me this little bitty thing. She says, honey, I'm not sure if that's what you want or not. And I was busy counseling somebody, so I couldn't answer her. She was trying to call me, but I couldn't talk to her. I wasn't going to stop counseling and talk to her. She was going to say, honey, are you sure they got this right? When I told her, I said, I want a family-sized spaghetti. I said, but I don't want deluxe. I want regular spaghetti. She wrote down he wants one serving of a regular-sized spaghetti. And I asked my family two or three times to make sure she understood that. I said, I'm not talking about a regular size. I said regular spaghetti in family size. And so, again, that's happening more and more everywhere you go. I pulled into the drive-thru the other day, a little while back, and Linda was driving. We were in a hurry trying to get somewhere, and so the lady did not even look out the drive-thru window. We pulled up, and the lady put her hand out like this and started doing like this while she's talking on her cell phone or something. And she's doing like this, and I watched Linda go. And she dropped the money, and part of it fell on the ground. The lady didn't say, thank you, I'm sorry, nothing. Handed her the food and closed the window. So that's the millennial, okay? You pay me for showing up. Not for going to a good job, just for showing up. So get used to that. And what we got to do is when you get a chance to be a teachable moment, teach them. But don't make people mad, just teach them. I've even called somebody at the counter before and said, have you been trained in this? And they go, what are you talking about? I said, has anybody ever trained you how to count change out? And they go, no, we just go by the machine. I said, what's that? The machine's breaking down. I said, I don't know. I said, it's obvious because the machine's down. You can't count it out. Let me show you how. And they go, oh, wow, thank you for showing me that. Yeah. Now, I'll tell you what I did the other day. This is me. I went to a rep. Again, this is over a scan of like a month. Stopped somewhere. I think it was like an Arby's. Stopped in and I said, I like to get, and Linda and I right now, said, I like to get two glasses of water along with our meal. We didn't want to drink some water. She said, okay, I looked over at the girl, the millennials, and I said, they've got a sign saying we have our more millennials than anybody else. Guys on the door. So I walked and I couldn't stand it. So I said, excuse me, ma'am. She says, yes, sir. I said, is this water decaffeinated? And she said, I don't know, sir. I have to ask somebody. And so she walks over and asks her manager, and her manager says, I'm not sure. I have to check on that for you. And so we go to eat, and I needed some sauce, so I go back to the counter, and I said, when I get back to the counter, and we get ready about to pray, and we'll tell you about it in a minute. She goes back to the counter, and I go back to the counter to get stuff, and everybody's gone. I said, where'd everybody go? She said, they're having a meeting in the back trying to decide if that water's decaffeinated or not. I kid you not. All right. Doug, you got 30 seconds. Hold on for a second.
I'd like to rest in the Lord and spend more time with
him. Awesome. Rest in the Lord. That doesn't mean not do anything. It means rest in him, and he'll do the work for you. That's some awesome stuff. We're going to go to this side after. We're getting ready. When you hear the alarm go off, I want you to make a bunch of the noise. Here it goes. 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. You ever stand to your feet? 2, 1. Stand to your feet. Thank you. talking today. You're beating the Christmas rush. All right, you can sit back down. Let me get these, then we're going to go. All right, y'all tell me. We got to listen to them. Your revolution. Amen. That's good.
To be what I ought to be, what I should be.
That's awesome. I like the way you said that. Awesome. Amen. Me too. Yes, Lord, yes.
I want to follow the example of the pattern son and be pleased with the Father.
Awesome. That's awesome. It'd be the last one. Are you getting ready? Are you still thinking? Okay. Hi, young man. Your name is back there?
Robinson.
Robinson. Yeah. All right, Robinson.
I want to be a better father and a better listener.
That's awesome. I like that. That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
To humble myself and to not want.
Okay. All right. That's right. Okay, that's good.
I want to release things to God when I pray. If you release it and leave it there, not worry about it anymore.
Awesome stuff.
I want to be more inviting towards others.
All right, that's good.
Be more of a people person.
Awesome.
Learn how to accept things that I can't change.
That's awesome. Y'all, everybody said something great. I mean, it's just amazing. Y'all are all saying something that means something. You're not just, picking them out of a hat.
Be there for them when they're depending
on it. I ain't got a thing. Okay. Procrastinate more. Starting in 2019.
I was gonna join the procrastinators club, but I keep putting it off. Okay.
Mine is to not have any whatsoever. No resolutions. To not have any resolutions whatsoever this year, so that when it's over with, I can actually say I've done it.
Did you just hear those five things? All right, is anybody up in there? I don't see anybody there. Okay, so it's back to you, young lady. That's good. That's good. And mine is, God, you show me and help me to do it. Because again, sometimes we think we got it together and we know what it is, and we can be so far off. And we can be so, so far off. And I learned that with my kids, I learned that with my wife. Again, by giving gifts that meant something to me, but it didn't mean anything to them because they didn't need it or that's not what they were looking for. And so as I started watching and listening, then I gave them something that they needed, and it was awesome and very powerful. Same way with God. God showed me and then gave me the wisdom and the strength to do it. Amen? Let's all stand up. Isn't this cool? We've already celebrated the new year, and we had a revolution. We didn't